Okay, we start off here with the span of infinity and the channel's helix factor. And this gentleman makes the statement that mass has objects beyond what we see.
That mathematicians have, in a certain sense, a larger world of reality than ordinary people like me, because mathematics has all sorts of objects in it that you cannot get at the corner grocery store, but which you can describe in enormous detail, you can follow in many, many ways. The mathematics world has a lot of extra things in it beyond what we can see ourselves. One obvious thing is higher dimensional spaces. We see three space dimensions and that's it. Then you can say, okay, today we have space-time, so that's four. Well, that's not necessarily that many, but for the world of mathematics, there are very interesting things, for example, to say about seven space dimensions, very special properties.
Physical existence.
Existence claims in mathematics in one system, and I think it's succeeded fairly well. And if you think about it, you realize that actually the physical existence claims are even more problematic. I mean, we can see there's this table here, and I can knock on it, and it feels solid, and so on. And so it seems that there is a table here, but what does it mean for something to exist physically? It's completely mysterious. I mean, it's related to the philosophical question
about that.
Why is there something rather than nothing? That's not the question I'm talking about. That's just the question, why is there something? But what does it mean to exist physically? I don't think you have any idea. You cannot give an account of it. You can observe the moons of Jupiter and so on and say, well, they exist and there are really moons orbiting Jupiter. But what does it mean for something to exist physically? It's completely mysterious. And in comparison, in mathematics, if I say, well, there's a set containing the empty set and that's it and no other members, we can give a pretty coherent account of what that means. I think much more coherent than any kind of explanation of what it means for something to exist physically.
The more discoveries that are made, the more questions are asked.
Well, but it'll keep going. It gets worse, right? Because we'll say, well, what's an atom? And you'll say, well, yeah, there's some electrons and protons and neutrons. I say, oh, that's great. What's a neutron? And you'll say, well, there's some quarks in there. And I'll say, well, what's a quark? And as we go further down in all this, it just dissolves into more and more equations. And I say, well, like, what's a quark? And you say something, well, there's this field, and there are these quantizations of the field, and there's going to be these incredibly complex mathematical operators that, you know, transform the field in certain ways into itself. And so physical existence, to get back to Joel's point, because I think Joel's right about this. I mean, I think so physical existence really ultimately seems to dissolve into mathematical existence.
Comparing the finite with infinity. Finite is limited, or having bounds. Infinity goes on forever, has no limits.
Universes, and I would ask you the question, you said maybe we should be satisfied with the finite, and I am completely unsatisfied with the finite. I mean, some mathematicians and philosophers have said that, you know, it's not infinity that's weird, it's the finite that's weird. Because from the perspective of infinity, the finite looks badly broken. And so why when I think of, if I think of things like, I hear all this, well, we can't get there, we can't go that far, we can't go around the circle infinitely many times because I guess my life will come to an end. Now, there certainly are lots of philosophers and theologians who have said, well, no, it won't. There are people who argue either for infinitely long lives, immortality. There are people who argue for even an infinite sequence of finite lives, maybe through reincarnation. And that wouldn't have to be in this universe. It could be Buddhists and Hindus, as well as Western thinkers, have argued for a plurality of universes with a plurality of incarnations.
Okay, so the show is Alien Planets and Possibility of Finding Life Beyond Our Solar System. The channel is Science and Technology for You, and first off we'll start off with the show, and it's talking about the discovery of a planet from a wobble of the Sun. So the Sun is wobbling because the planet is acting on the gravity of the Sun.
Oh, is violently lurching and wobbling.
What we discovered, it's one of these stars have a velocity changing its time.
What is powerful enough to disturb a star the size of our sun? Mayor offers a radical answer. A planet.
Yeah, so that stands to reason, and there's a website you can help scientists find planets, and it measures the dip in the amount of sun coming from a star as the planet passes across it. Here he talks about Cygnus B, which is a planet that swings in close, very close to the star, and then swings out into space, and that's its orbit.
Astronomer Jeff Marcy discovers something shocking about a planet orbiting a star called 16 Cygnus B, located some 70 light-years away in the constellation of Cygnus, the Swan.
The planet was clearly in an elongated orbit, bringing the planet close to and then far from the host star. And this, of course, defied our expectations based on our own solar system, where all of the planets go around our sun in nearly circular orbits like phonograph grooves in a record.
My opinion is that swinging in so close to the sun would be far too hot for water or life to exist, and then far too cold as the planet swings out into space. Here he says that hibernation could be a way of surviving the heat and cold temperatures.
There could be life forms that are smart enough to hibernate, as do animals on the Earth during the winter season. If this sounds fantastic, I offer you the tidal zones on the Earth. On the tidal zones, life proliferates, of course, near the seashore, and they do so despite tides. The water coming in, covering many of the life forms, the water going out at low tide, and yet those species survive perfectly well.
I would say that with no water, no life can survive. On the other hand, that life could burrow right into, deep into the planet and survive that way. Also, at this point in time, there's probably no way of telling whether or not the planet rotates as it goes close to the sun. If it doesn't rotate, life could survive on the back half of the planet, maybe. Here, Lawrence Krauss talks about the evidence of the Big Bang. He says that everything will disappear because gravity is pushing everything away and dark energy is replacing it, or dark energy is acting on the planets and everything within the universe to drive everything apart at ever increasing rates, that eventually when we look out into the sky, there simply won't be anything there.
We thought the universe was in 1900. Why? Let me go. I will argue that every single piece of data that tells us there was a Big Bang will disappear. The first bit of data that will disappear is the Hubble expansion. Hubble's great discovery in 1929, the universe is expanding, was based on looking at galaxies and the motion of galaxies. But in 100 billion years or so, to a trillion years, there will be no galaxies. Every galaxy outside of our own will have disappeared. It'll be moving away from us faster than the speed of light, and will therefore be invisible.
My view on that is that if the Big Bang theory is true, if there is expansion, then that'll be the case, that when you look out into space, there won't be anything there. But the Big Bang theory, it's just something about it. I just can't really believe in it. The planets and everything seeming to move away everything moving away from everything else could have something to do with gravitational lensing, just the effect that is observed with the experiments. But I just can't sort of believe in it. Yeah, as I say. Okay, the next video, the speaker is Lee Smolin, and it's the Perimeter Institute on Time Reborn. The channel is Perimeter Institute of Theoretical Physics. Here he talks about the fact that we can't measure a small part of the world because it is influenced by the rest of the world. I suppose here he means in a minute way, a precise way.
There's a problem, which is that every application of physics to a small part of the world is approximate. It can't be exact. We can't model a small part of the world exactly, because there's an infinite number of small ways in which the outer world messes with the world that we're modeling. We can say we're making a model of everything that's going on in this auditorium, but there's cosmic rays coming through. We can try to shield those. There's neutrinos that come through. There's gravity waves that come through. We can't pretend that any part of the world is isolated from the rest, but when we do physics this way, we do that. So everything is based on an approximation, which is fine because we know how to control those approximations. But we say, oh, we can make our theories better and better by making them, this room is too small of a domain, let's make it involve the whole solar system. But there are cosmic rays coming from outside the solar system, let's make it involve the whole galaxy. But there are gravity waves coming from outside the galaxy, and so on, until we get to the whole universe. Okay. So there's this idea that we're always working with approximations, but we can make our science better and better by taking bigger and bigger domains. But then we get to the domain of the universe as a whole, and there's only one system, and the method we're using breaks down. That's a dilemma, and Roberto Unger and I call that the cosmological dilemma. We have to live with the fact that all our models describe only approximations. When we ignore that and pretend that we can take the method of science that Newton developed that works so well for small parts of the universe to large and apply it to the whole universe, we commit a fallacy. We call that the cosmological fallacy.
That makes sense to me. Everything is influenced by something else. If I go to the city and I try and walk down the street and I try and walk in a straight line, I won't be able to, because I have to get out of the way of other people, get out of the way of cars, trucks and buses. People going into shops, coming out of shops, etc. And it's much the same as the small being influenced by the large in the galaxy. Our reality is moments in time, forward moments in time. Maths can be verified at any given time.
And of course the right answer to a question like that is we don't know. Lou Kaufman, who's a very eminent, influential topologist, has speculated about that there could be ways in which, if you stray into areas of mathematics where contradiction is allowed, so that you run one of these arguments where you run into a statement, then it's negation, then a statement, then it's negation, which are just supposed to be excluded from mathematics, that could be creating some kind of motion in time. And what do I really think of that? What I really think about that is that it's not going to work. It sounds good. And here's why. Because when I say that time is real, I'm pointing to the world having a property that no mathematical object can have. And I need to name a property, and then I'll convince you that the world cannot be modeled by a mathematical object. And here's one, that it's always some moment. It's always some moment. Here in the real world, it's always some moment, and then it's gone, and then it's the next moment, and then it's the next moment, it's the next moment. Mathematical objects, by definition, are timeless. They have properties which can be examined and verified at any time. So, if there is a kind of logical mathematical structure that is so weird that it's not timeless, I don't know why it would be called mathematics.
Our reality is moments forward in time. A mathematical experiment can be verified at any time. Although a house and a car can also be manufactured and built at a certain time. And last of all, very interesting observation, and that is a truth always true? Or only true at the time? Is a truth true before and after it is determined?
One of the things that I mean by time being real is that what is real in a moment of time and only in a moment of time. Are all truths true outside of time? Or are truths true only in moments of time? Does time emerge from law? As I'll be explaining, the dominant point of view in my profession now is that the laws of nature come first and are stated in a way which is timeless, in which time plays no fundamental role, and time emerges as a kind of large-scale phenomenon, the way the temperature does, or pressure. Or do laws emerge from time, which is the view that I'll be arguing for? Is time prior to law, or is law prior to time? You may not even have thought that there's a choice to be made there. And this is one of the things that I really understood in my discussions with Roberto Unger. It's one or the other, and I'll be suggesting why as we go along. Is the future already determined? Lots of people talk about determinism. The laws of nature, if you know everything in the laws of nature, will tell you exactly what the future will be, or maybe not. The standard view among people who believe, quote, in the scientific worldview is that the future is determined by the laws of physics acting on the present. I'm going to argue that that's not the case.